interactive session. I don't like to just talk. Just ask questions. If you don't ask, I will ask questions. So the choice is yours. So and if you feel answer right, if the question is good, not the answer right. Answer right, you get a prize. If the question is good, I still give you a prize. So please ask questions because that's what kind of stimulates us when people ask questions. So this is talking about an insight into plasma. Now most of you have heard the word plasma, right? But if I ask you if I ask a common who don't know, who's not a science person, what is plasma? I generally get two answers. One is how it's in our blood. So, second thing they say is plasma is a fourth state of matter. Okay, what next? They ask one more question, is it itna hi humko pata hai? That is the problem, because plasma is such a vast subject. And unfortunately, it is not being taught at plus two levels or the BSc level. It's not being taught as seriously as it should be. So that is why we are taking this simple talk to the public. So this beautiful picture you see is our campus. It's called Institute for Plasma Research, and we are located in Gandhinagar, in Gujarat. And this is how our campus looks. And you are most welcome to visit. Now let's proceed. Now, you need to know about two things. One is science and one is technology. The difference between the two is important. Science is understanding natural processes, and of course you need to. The second thing is, once you know the natural process, you try and exploit this process for the benefit of mankind. Yes.
How do scientists get to know that plasma is slightly alkaline?
Slightly?
Alkaline.
That is different plasma. You are talking about the plasma in the blood. And to test alkalinity, what do you do? You put a litmus paper. Right? So there are various chemical methods to understand the acidity of the plasma. But this plasma is different. This is not the one in the blood. This is also called a plasma. Okay? So understand these two things. What is science and what is technology? How do you differentiate the two? Science is understanding of a phenomena, and technology is how you convert that understanding of that phenomena into something that is useful for mankind. Okay? Let's go forward. Now just see this. Look at this number. 99.9999% of the entire known universe. There is a known universe and an unknown universe. Because you are humans. You don't know everything. So there is a part of the known universe that we know till now. 99.999% of the whole universe is in the state of plasma. So you, me, every being on this earth, the carbon in our DNA, the iron in our blood, everything, we owe it to the stars. Because all these elements initially was born in some star somewhere. So we are all star kids, you can say that. Okay, let's proceed again. Okay, as I said, we all probably owe existence to plasma in one way or the other. And this is important. Plasma is very useful, can be applied to solve many problems of mankind, and that is what we address today. Yeah. Let's see what are the things that, you know, plasma. By the way, how many of you have visited the exhibition? Okay, I think you should take out some time and visit the exhibition, then you will get more about how plasma can be used to solve Earth's energy problem. We'll come to that first. So, and this is also important. You know, it's a very new topic for the Indian curriculum. You go to any school or college or university, not many people teach this subject. That is because we don't have any, nobody knows about it. So unless a university or a college knows about a subject, they cannot ask their management to give this as a core paper or an auxiliary paper. That's what we're trying to do. Now let's see. How old is plasma on Earth? See, in the Stone Age, when people first made fire, fire is the simplest form of plasma that you can find on Earth. You can see that. So can we say that the usage of plasma began in the Stone Age? I don't think any other technology that has evolved on Earth is this old. So this is one thing you need to appreciate. The use of plasma began much earlier than we actually thought. Now let's see. I'm just taking you back to some kind of a history. Now, all of you are aware of this concept of panchabhutas. Now you can compare them with what we know about the four states of matter also. We can have the earth, prithvi, which is, you can take it as solid. Then we have the water, gel. So you have solid form, liquid form, and there's vayu, there's gas form. Then you have fire and akash. Now these two can be called as the plasma, because fire is plasma, and space, 99.999% is plasma. So, I don't know. So, do we think that our ancient people who lived in India, they were aware of these things? I leave it to you. Now look, if you see a thing like this, it's time for a question. So this is the first question I'm going to ask. Does anybody know? How do you know what is the, you have reached space? I take you up into the atmosphere. At what point can you say that, okay, now I've reached space? If today you read in the paper that the rocket has put inside one bee into space. Anybody has an answer, you can raise that, otherwise we'll pass on, we'll come back to it later. Okay? So the answer to this is, it's called the Karman line. It's an imaginary line that's about 100 kilometers above the surface of Earth. And beyond, which is actually defined by this physicist called Theodor von Karman. And what he suggested was that beyond this limit, air is too thin to support flight. You must have heard of how does a plane fly? Because of the wings. It encounters the air particles in it. So there is, because of Bernoulli's effect, there is difference in pressure, top and bottom of the wing. And since the pressure from bottom is higher, it lifts the entire plane. At that height, air is so thin that it cannot support flight. So he defined this as a Karman layer. So this is one piece of information for you. Now let's get to what exactly is plasma. So it was first identified by Sir William Crookes in way back in 1879. What he did was he created a discharge. We used an electrode, a anode and a cathode, and applied high voltage to it, and something happened inside. So that is what first, the first instance of, what's this? So you can see it forming a shadow. When it takes off, the shadow is gone. So he said that it's a combination of some kind of particles inside, which actually, why, how did you know this particle? It was casting a shadow. So this is a first Crookes tube, and this formed the basis of things like old TV. Remember the old TV used to be big, because it used to have such a cathode ray tube, and the cathode rays coming out of the tube used to actually scan the TV screen to show you the picture. Now things are different. Now we have things which fit in your pocket. Those days, all of us know that TVs were big in size, fat in size, and it occupied a lot of space on your table. So let's see. So it was a British scientist, Langlois, who actually gave the name plasma to this whatever he found. And it was Professor Saha, who was from Calcutta. He was one of India's pioneering scientists who contributed to plasma physics. So let's go forward again. Okay, now again, what exactly is this plasma? So we talk about plasma, so we take, let's take an example. Just take some ice and you give a little bit of heat to it. What happens? It becomes water, right? You give some more heat. What does it become? It boils. And it becomes steam. So now you have reached third stage. Now, just imagine you give much more heat. Let's say something like 11,000 degrees centigrade. Extremely hot temperature if you give. What will happen is the oxygen and hydrogen in the water, they will split. And let's take one hydrogen. Hydrogen is the simplest atom you can have. It has one nucleus and one electron. And it is stable and it is neutral. And it is neither positive nor negative. Now what I do is I give it enough energy to knock out one electron from it. Now what is remaining? The one electron, and you have a central part which is now positively charged, because the negative is gone from there. So you one electron and one positively charged particle, that, and not one, many of them, that whole ensemble of material, ions, the positive ones are called ions, the negative ones are called electrons, and those who have not been ionized. So there are three things now, plus, minus and neutral. The whole mixture of this is called plasma. So that is what we generally end up with. So actually, can you make water plasma? You cannot. Why is that? Because if you give that much temperature, the water breaks down into oxygen and hydrogen. So you have oxygen plasma and hydrogen plasma, but not a water plasma. And for that you need about 11,000 degrees centigrade. But in the first slide I said that all our origin we attributed to plasma. So shouldn't that be the first state of matter? Think about it. Okay. This you can skip, but just to show you the different description of the one which was mentioned earlier. This is solid. Everything is fixed. All the molecules are in a fixed position. In liquid, it is a little more free to move around. In gas, it is actually free to move around. And when it becomes plasma, they move around freely. They also interact with each other. That is why plasma is more unique. I'll come to that. Now, can you name any natural occurring plasma? What else?
Lighting.
Very good. Then. I heard one something coming from there. In the first slide I showed you, it's a natural occurring thing. Every day morning you go and switch it on. Fire is a plasma, lightning is plasma. Anything else that you've seen? In your house it is there. Tube light. Then? TV, yeah. If you have a plasma TV, yes. Definitely yes. Very good. I'll explain how it works. So plasma TV, you already have four things. There are much more. So we can go ahead again. Okay. It has come to certain natural plasma. So that fire, somebody mentioned fire, yes. Solar flares, you must not have seen them, but you must have heard about them, right? That is plasma. There is something called as corona discharge. It is used, have anybody used air purifiers at home? So they use this technique. What happens if you have a very, very single point and you apply very high potential to that point, at that very sharp point the electric density is so high it will break down the air around it. And because it breaks down the air around it, it can form ozone. So ozone is actually, it actually destroys bacteria and all that. So it generally keeps the air clean. So corona discharge, all of you must have heard this. Yes, aurora borealis in the north and aurora, I don't know the name, yeah. So the northern and southern lights. So let's see how these things move. This also is interesting, I'll come to that. So let's just watch your aurora. What does it look like? It's actually one of the most spectacular, what is it, occurrences in nature. So let's take a look at this. Now observe this. It's actually a plane. The photos taken, the video is taken from the cockpit. You see those sparks flying around? Well, I'll explain that now. If you next time when you go to the airport, when you board the plane, just look at the windshield of the plane. You can see the glass in the windshield is attached to the plane. You see so many rivets. Now when the plane flies through a what is called as a thunderstorm. The clouds are very charged, right? That's how you have lightning. When the plane flies through that, all those small nuts and rivets, they act as high voltage points. And then they form the discharge. So actually, kind of same corona discharge. But it used to be called St. Elmo's fire. Because in olden days, when the sailors used to sail in the seas, they used to have those huge masts. And the mast used to have an iron tip on the top. So during stormy season, and then the ship used to go into the storm, the charged particle used to come at the top and it used to blow. So the sailors used to wonder what is happening. And Saint Elmo is the patron saint of sailors. So they used to think that the saint is blessing them or something. That's how the name came, Saint Elmo's fire. Of course you must have seen the sun, everybody knows what the sun is. You must have seen galaxies, not in with a telescope. must have seen in print, right? All of you must have seen. Lightning, of course. It's the most common and most spectacular after, I would say, after this event that Earth has. And most common display of plasma by nature is the lightning. We'll come to lightning now. I will skip this. This again shows the different kinds of plasma that we are talking about. The range. From here you have, this is actually the temperature. You have plasma that is of 100 degrees temperature to 100 million degrees centigrade. Look at the range. Density, don't worry about this. This is the number of particles per unit volume. So you forget about it. Just look at the temperature itself. So depending on what application you want, you have to choose the right plasma at the right temperature and at the right density. We will come to that. This is just a descriptive feature to show the entire range of plasma. Your fusion reactors will come here. It requires extremely high temperatures. Now let us just talk about the simple flame, which I said in the beginning is the most simplest form of plasma, right? All of you agree that? So this is how a flame, if you look at the structure of the flame in terms of charged particles, will look like this. Extremely low temperature, but then you can ask, the flame is hot. If I am saying plasma is low temperature, but why is the flame hot? That's due to an entirely different reason. Because the flame burns hydrocarbon. And every fuel has what is called as a calorific value. If you take 1 gram of anything, if you burn it, it can give out a particular amount of energy. In this case, most of the energy comes from actually burning of wax in a candle. And in the gas, which is from the hydrocarbon that you burn. So, essentially, it's actually the flame is having charged particles separation inside the flame. How do you know that? Let's take a look. So if it is a plasma, it's a charged particle, so it should be effective, it should have some effect if I expose it to either an electric or magnetic field. So let's check whether that is possible or not. So now see this. This is actually the magnetic, the actual normal candle flame. And the magnetic field is increasing. You see, as the magnetic field increases, the flame is suppressed. So that means magnetic field is having an effect. Now let us look at electric field. What should be there? Now what's that flame? See, this is a wire. These are two wires, positive and negative. When you apply voltage, when there is no voltage, you see what happens. The flame is normal. Now the voltage is applied. What difference did you see in the flame? The flame is attracted towards one side. So now it's having an effect on magnetic field, it's having an effect on electric field. So now are you convinced that flame is also a plasma? I hope you are.
Yes.
Okay? So now I am asking a question. Can a flame cast a shadow?
Yes.
Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, let's see how many yes. 1, 2, and how many no's? Okay, that's good. So let's take a look whether that is possible or not. Now, how does the shadow, how do you get the shadow? When you walk or when you keep something, the light falls on it, light does not pass, it will form a shadow. Light passes, if you put a glass piece, you cannot get actual shadow, you might get a shape but not a shadow. So light has to be blocked or absorbed or whatever. Now let's see if you take a normal flame. I think you should go and try this at home. Is there a shadow? So this is a normal, match in the candle, and you put white light. Is there a shadow? No. But you will see certain things, air moving like this. That is different thing. It doesn't cast a shadow. But how can you make it cast a shadow? Let's take a look at that. Right? How do you get the flame to cast a shadow? See this. This now there is no shadow. Look at that. So you can actually make the flame cast a shadow, but you have to use a little physics trick here. You have to ensure, you can see what is the difference between these two. The stark difference that you find.
Light.
That is it. So here everything is yellow, right? That is the clue to this. Now what you do is, you remove all the white light and just put pure yellow light. And put some salt into this. Salt is sodium chloride. Sodium has a very strong absorption line in the yellow region. You must have seen the sodium vapor line on the road. It's yellowish, right? Slightly yellowish. That is because of the sodium vapor has a very sodium has a very strong line in the yellow region. Now what happens is when you put salt into this, the salt will absorb all the yellow light coming into it, and what remains? Black. So you can actually create shadow in a frame, but it requires little bit of physics trick. So let's watch a small video about that you'll understand. Now watch this. Now that's the flame, there's no sodium, there's no salt in it. The moment you put that paper soaked in salt water into that, just watch what happens.
Paper soaked in salt water.
See that? Mm-hmm. This is a sodium vapor lamp. From this side he's putting sodium vapor lamp. When all the sodium goes in, the blackness also goes. Watch. Gone. As long as there is sodium, the flame will be black in color and it can create a shadow. So you can try this out in school when you go. Okay, so now let's look at one more thing that is called the lightning. But these are things which all of you must have encountered, so that's why I'm taking these as examples. Now, lightnings, these are some interesting facts. You know, as I said, one of the most spectacular displays of lightning is called Elstree. And one small lightning, even a small lightning discharge, has about 30 lakh volts at about 30,000 ampere. If you multiply these two, you will get the power. It is equivalent to power that can light a home for a few months. Every lightning. So then you can ask me the question, if this is a lightning here, why don't we use it? What are we scientists sitting here for? You can ask. But the question is not that. The answer is, we cannot store so much of huge power in such a. You can see this number. Lightning lasts for less than a fraction of a second. In such small time, you have so much of power coming, how do you store it? We don't have batteries that are so big that can accept all that power. Neither do we have capacitors that can accept that much charge within a short time. But there is some hope. Now scientists have been developing what is called as a supercapacitor. I don't go in detail. They are just supercapacitors. Big. They look small, but they have lot of, they can store a lot of energy. Now, if you have a whole tank of the supercapacitors, you connect a wire to your lightning arrestor and boom, when the lightning comes, all the power goes to the wire and the capacitor and it stays there. From there you can draw. So there is future. Who knows, maybe 50 years from now, we will be harvesting lightning as and when it is available. You cannot make lightning in the sky, but when it is there, you can harvest it. However you do it, either put a big rod or what scientists do to actually capture that lightning is that they fire a very thin wire. They put a big coil of wire downstairs in the lab, and then they fire a rocket with this wire. As the rocket goes up, it pulls this wire. When it reaches the cloud, the lightning sees I get a fantastic path to go to Earth. Just comes down to that wire. So that is how scientists actually study lightning. Okay, now some fun part. Have you heard of ball lightning? There are various kinds of lightning, right? Between clouds you get lightning. Have you ever seen lightning from a plane? Sitting in an aircraft, you can see lightning that goes from one cloud to another, not to ground. That is also there. It is also called what is called the ball lightning. This is a ball lightning. See how it looks like. But we still do not know what is actual physics behind the evolution of ball lightning. Watch this video. You'll find a lightning that comes straight from here. Watch this area. And I run the video. There it comes. See that? That's an incidence of ball lightning. Normally we associate lightning to a streak of light. Now what is that light? It is nothing but plasma. When you know how lightning happens, right? You during thunderstorm, the clouds are charged, and then this ground and the charge build up is so high, it just flashes over, right? So when the flashover happens, what happens is, as the flash advances, it actually ionizes the air, nitrogen. So what you see is nitrogen plasma. And what is the sound that you hear? Because it's so fast, the sudden expansion causes what is called a shock wave. And this shock, you must have seen those, what do you call it? Hunter. Why does hunter make sound when you do that? It is because the tip of the hunter moves at supersonic speeds. And the shock wave that it produces, by the time it reaches our ears, comes like a big noise. Same thing happens in the lightning. Okay? Now this question. What happens if the lightning strikes a flying plane? Will something happen? Let's take a look. What's that video?
Okay, does anybody have the answer?
You must wind me. Can you give me my copy? Give an answer. Does anybody have an answer before I show the video? What would happen to the plane? Will it crash or will it just fly out? Or will people be happy about it? Generally, what happens? Take a look. So what's that? See that? Did anything happen to you?
No.
Any guesses why?
There's no charge.
No. But where does it connect to?
It's not have charge.
Who said that? No. It's not about charge. Charge is there. That's why you have a lightning. There's an effect called Faraday effect. Wherein the charge always passes through the surface of the metal because it doesn't penetrate. So in this case, when she saw that the lightning came from here, it went all around the plane, just went down straight. It's like supposing you are in a thunderstorm. The best, safest place is inside your car. You'll never get hit by lightning. And when you step out, chances that you're going to hit by lightning is there. Because the car is made of metal, it gives a metallic shield around you. So if any lightning hitting your car, you can just go outside the metal on the surface and then go down to the ground. So this is called, it's called a Faraday cage. So you make a cage of any metal, you sit inside that, no lightning can touch you, I can guarantee you that. Okay? So now let's go a little further. Okay, now there's a question here. Can actually current travel through insulator? You know what is the conductor and the insulator, right? Conductor, current will pass, insulator, current will not pass. Copper, current will pass, plastic, current will not pass. Wood, current will not pass. But can you make it happen? Let's take a look. If anybody has an answer, they can answer. If you say yes, I need an explanation.
Yes.
Okay, let's hear it.
I have never tried, but I am thinking of it doesn't pass through wood. But if the wood is wet.
Perfect. Give it a talk. Let's see a small demonstration of that. Basically, what happens is the voltage is kept like extremely high voltages. It can break down these barriers. If you give a little bit of wetness, that is enough for the electricity to conduct. Let's take a look at that video. What is your claim? Please identify yourself. What do you do? What is your name?
I am Padmashree Pandey. And I am a housewife and take care of my kids well.
Very good.
That's it.
Very good. So let's go ahead. Okay, now let's see this. There's something called as Lichtenberg figures. It's actually named after a scientist. So you must have this structure seems very familiar, right? You must have seen it somewhere in your in life. So let's see how this is actually made in a block of plastic perspex. So you can see this. See this block of perspex? Same thing. This block of perspex is charged to very high voltages, let's say 100,000 volts. It charges it, so what happens is, this is an insulator. So all the electrons in this are trapped. So when you're exposed to high voltages, basically electrostatic charge, there's something called electrostatics. Take a comb and put it on your hair and show it to petrol, it attracts, that's electrostatic. That builds up inside this. I'm not talking about 1 volt or 2 volts, billions of hundreds of millions of volts are building up. They cannot escape because this is an insulator. They're trapped inside. Now if you give them one little chance to escape, then that thing will escape. Let's see how they escape. So just watch this. What you're going to do, this is an iron. In needle. So he's going to hit it with this. And that gives a possible path of ground. See what happens. See that? What just happened there? These are electrons from everywhere. They form a path and come towards the exit path. These figures are absolutely crucial. Okay, now let's see in wood what happens. Actually, a piece of wood, but actually left. When he's applying high voltage on both sides, see what happens? Forms figures like this. Actually form of arc. People do it as a form of arc. So now, just read this. Actually one of the points of nature is the forms are not spheres, mountains are not cones, crystals are not circles, and bark is much more, not a lightning travel in a straight line. That is nature's ways. Now I am asking a question now. Now what happens if you get hit by lightning? See this $5 man's body? He survived to still tell the story. So if you ever survive lightning strike, you will get a free tattoo by nature. This is called Lichtenberg figures. Actually now it's called an art form. Okay, now let's go to some man-made plasma. This you must have seen. Neon lamps, they are everything seen out all over the place. What else? You must have heard about the plasma-based cutting and welding. This everybody must have seen as part. At some point of time, your house this happens. So in principle, all of you have encountered plasma at one point or other in your life. But there are much more complex things, like spacecraft propulsion system is used as a plasma engine. You can see an exhibition in our working model is there in our exhibition. These are what's called as fusion devices. You can see in the main exhibition we have images of this. This is actually for increasing the surface hardness. This also you can see in our exhibition. These are plasma torches, which is used for extremely high temperature applications. That also you can see in our thing. This also you can see. So there are various plasma we make to suit our application. That you will hear in the next talk. I won't touch upon this one. Let's go forward again. This is interesting. Morning, somebody is a tube light. Who said tube light? You said yes. At least she also needs a talk. So let's take a tube light. Go home. I don't know how many people use tube lights now. You go home and look at your tube light. You will see something like this, right? You remember? You know there's something called a 6500 Kelvin return here. Let's zoom it in and see. See that? 6500 Kelvin. How hot is that? Very, very hot. Right? But you're able to touch it, right? You can still touch a tube light while it is on. Right? Now it is hot. You can still touch it. Okay, if anybody knows the answer, they can tell that they will get 2 cups. But I know I'll answer this. So this is, so you know, everybody knows how a tube light works, right? I'm assuming that. You have mercury plasma generated inside. Mercury produces UV, ultraviolet light. And that ultraviolet light, you can hit that white coating on the tube light. Has anybody broken a tube light? Yeah. And white powder in there. That powder is a fluorescent powder. So when this UV light from the plasma hits the inner surface, he encounters the powder will absorb the UV and become white light. It's how you see white light in tube light. You can make any color actually, provided you get the right material. Plus I also seen in some restaurants, they have this glowing letters. What is that? What they do, they don't put the white coating inside the tube light. Gives you UV light, which you cannot see, but the paint in which it is written, that will absorb it in either fluorescence or phosphorus. Two things can happen. That is what happens. Now let us see how this is possible. Yes?
In the recent years, you also see tube lights which change colors, basically from white light to
that is not a tube light, it contains LED inside.
Yeah. Does that have any correlation to
the absolutely not. Absolutely. Because nowadays, when somebody says tube light, there is nothing, no tube light in that.
Right.
It's only LEDs inside the shape of a tube light. That LED can be made in 3 colors, RGB.
Right.
So now we have mobile application, it connects to your tube light and you can what's called as a mood lighting.
Right.
If you want a happy mood, you can have, you can put blue color, and an angry mood, you can put red color. It's up to you. So that is a different thing altogether. So now let's talk about this. Let's see how do you resolve this? I'm saying that it is 6500 Kelvin, it's almost 6000 degrees centigrade. Very hot, but you have to touch it. I'll give you a simple example. You take ice. Ice is at what temperature? 0 degrees centigrade. No doubts about that, right? and take a small speck of ice and put it on your face. Will you feel it? You will feel something has touched it, that's it. But the same ice, if you take 1 kilo of it and put it on your face, you will of course feel it. So what is the difference between these two? Temperature is the same, material is the same, density. So density is different. Exactly what is happening here. The plasma is actually at this temperature, but the number of density, that is the number of electrons or number of ions that are produced in the plasma is extremely low. It cannot carry this entire heat to the surface. But that does not mean that it's not hot. You keep your hand for a long time, you feel the heat. That is not enough to justify this 65,000. So this what defines the difference between a hot plasma and a cold plasma. So depending on the application you want, you have to decide whether your device should be able to produce hot plasma or cold plasma. Now let's see what are the examples of hot and cold plasma. So in hot plasma, there is 100% ionization. Now what does this mean? If I have 100 mercury atoms inside this, if all the 100 becomes plasma, then it is hot plasma. So where do you find hot plasma? Surface of the sun is the most obvious example. Then you have lightning, yes. Then you have plasma melting. Here, because this is very hot, you ensure that all the gas molecules there are in the state of plasma. It's very hot, very dense. What are the cold plasma, where only 1% ionization is there? You have fluorescent lamp, neon lamps, atmospheric plasmas, like you know the solar, what you see. All those are very cold plasma. So nobody answers this, right? Yet. Do I get the prize? Okay, fine, let's go ahead. Okay, now let's have a fun with plasma. Okay, so let's take a few examples where this all of you must have seen is a plasma globe. Very simple things available in the market. I'll show you some stuff which you probably might have not seen. So let's take a look at this. This is nothing but a discharge between, this is an iron electrode here, one is plus and minus minor, actually keep oscillating. Let's not think of that. Let's see what happens when you change some parameters like pressure or voltage. Just watch that video. I said that when you have a charged particle, you bring a magnetic field to it, it will react. How it reacts, that we can decide. Sorry, you can use that reaction to our own benefit. You can see this in our exhibition. You take a look at it, play around with it. So here, you're actually, in the first when you saw this thing moving up and down, you're actually changing the voltage and pressure. When you keep it constant, these are the magnets. When you bring the magnets around it, you can actually confine the best. Only you confine a plasma. You need magnetic field. If you have magnetic field, the plasma cannot touch it. So this is, now I'll come to another interesting plasma effect that you can see. Now watch this. These are actually dust particles in plasma. See how they're moving? Where have you seen such things in our universe? Some planet has some things like this. What are those things called? Rings. They are dust rings. And first line I said 99.99% of the universe is in plasma state. What happens is dust in the plasma environment acts like a plasma. Also these are particles that you can see when you shine a laser on them, you can see them moving. That is because plasma is what is called as a collective behavior. You must have seen those birds flying in the morning, in summer mornings. Big, huge swarms of birds, when one bird moves, everybody moves like that. They call collective behavior. Unlike a gas, if I have a chamber full of gas, the gas molecule sitting on this corner of the chamber, you don't bother what is happening in that corner. It takes care of himself only. Plasma is not like that. Very interfering, it has a mind of its own, actually a crazy mind of its own. Now, if a plasma electron is sitting here, I'm bothered about what is the electron sitting in that corner of the room. I don't interact with him. So what happens is it creates a lot of issues. There are what's called instabilities. In any system, to be working properly, it has to be stable. And humans are like that. We are instable, unstable, of course we cannot survive. So every system tries to go into a stable state. But plasma is not like that. biggest pain for us is that particular feature of plasma. It cannot sit properly. It's like, you know, holding a snake. You can hold a snake in the front and the back. That will be stable. What happens in the center? It's not doing this, right? If you hold in the center, what happens? Both sides will start. It's exactly like a snake. So this is a laboratory demonstration of what happens to dust in plasma. I'm not asking you to move like this. I'm not giving it any incentive to move like that. But dust by itself, yeah.
Okay.
Flame.
And you have candles around it.
Okay.
You tend to see that these flames move gradually towards the.
No, that could be just because of the air, hot air moves up.
So
this is the low pressure producer. Air from outside will rush in. That will change the.
Not necessarily.
It cannot impact this long because flame plasma is extremely weak, very, very weak.
Okay.
So put a normal magnet, nothing will happen. It's extremely high magnetic feature. It was extremely deep plasma, so that cannot create that much of impact. There are two different plasmas sitting in two different places, there is air in between, so it cannot impact much.
Okay.
Inside the plasma, yes, they do impact, yes.
Okay.
But what you must have seen is because this is because of air trapped.
I'm not complaining. As you know that the we can store the light
length. Okay? No, I'm not saying we can store.
We can
there is a possibility.
Future,
yeah.
Possibility.
Yes, yes.
So is it going to be future and it be possible in between the space of Earth, within the Earth, you know, between and
mantle,
and bone, the portion of mantle will be able to store it up. Is it possible?
No, not the. Why do you think you have stored it in the mantle?
Because the thing is that we need the space to get storage for that. See, just like Big Bang, I'm talking about the nuclear experiment we are doing for the same. So that more than 30 years beyond that, we will change our free lightning.
No, 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 just not concept wrong there. See, what you're talking about is the last hadron collider.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
That has to be underground because it requires huge amount of space. So it's about 10 kilometers, or I don't know what to take that anymore. Yeah, it's huge. So which country will allow you to put it on the surface? Are you occupying that much land? When you go down, there's no problem. No? And also why you're going down is you're trying to avoid other disturbances. That's why there's nothing to do. And about storing in the Earth mantle, it's not a thing that is possible. Why? It's just voltage. It's like, you know, your tank is leaking. At say 10 liters per 100 liters per second. You have only a bucket. What will you do? You need a big bucket, right?
Yeah.
It's the same way. You know, the lightning needs an extremely big bucket to store it. So someday somebody will make it, you will start using it. Until then. No. No question is, I'll tell you two things. No question is stupid. And it's not a shame to say I don't know. Remember these two things. Teach them to your kids also. Not stupid to ask any question. You should ask. And also, if I don't know, I will say I don't know. There's no shame in that. But if I say I don't know, it's my duty to go and find out the answer. So that's it. No question stupid. Don't worry. So can I go from?
Yeah.
So I said in this thing, I'm not asking this to move in this pattern. I'm not giving it any incentive. I'm creating a plasma, I'm putting dust into it. You can see this piece here. This is one electrode on the top. Like you see here, there's two electrodes on the top and on the bottom. Now, once I get plasma particular density, I introduce very fine dust, it's about nano size dust into it. Like maybe iron particles or, you know, silica, whatever. And those dust, they start interacting with each other and start moving. So this is something which you can see the formation of planets. When a universe is formed, how did our universe form? There was something which happened in the beginning, which formed the sun. The remaining particles started coalescing, started joining together. And it becomes bigger and bigger. There is a particular mass, then the gravity happens, and then it becomes a planet or non-planet, whatever you want. What happens to those particles which could not be lucky enough to go join a planet? They become a moon, or they become a ring. In the ring is nothing but dust, charged dust. I'll show you how. If you look at how Saturn's rings are behaving, you'll understand why it is important to study these things in the lab. This is called dusty plasma, because dust is put into a plasma. And that dusty plasma also got a lot of applications.
which you will hear from Chaya in the next talk. I will proceed again. I have seen, where do you see Dasi Brahma? Somebody said Saturn. Who said Saturn? I think you should give her one. Did you already get one? I think you should give her one. Okay, let's go forward in the meantime. Okay, I'll just come to just a brief as to where we find Dasi Brahma in our universe. You can see the amount of places where dusty plasma, which is taking one of the plasma, right from solar AAA, planetary AAA, supernova, interplanetary, molecular clouds, everything. This is in the cosmic entire universe. Now you take our solar system, cometary tails, dust tail and gas tail. That's why when it comes to the sun, it changes direction. Okay? Then you have, this is the moon of Saturn. Look at this jets. This is nothing but dusty particles coming out of it. In fact, our own moon is supposed to be having a very thin ring, which was actually discovered in 2013 by the NASA explorer. So it's supposed to be a very weak, thin disk of dust, which is not visible in telescopes, but through other studies they have actually found out. Even the Saturn rings, of course. Now what's this? This is one of the moons of Saturn. This is a ring. One of this is called the F ring. The rings are named as ABCD here. Now look at this variation in the ring as the moon passes. Watch it, I'll show that video. Watch it. See what happens to that? See that? See here? It is doing something to the ring. So that is also because rings are all charged. You have another body coming towards it. It will interact. When it interacts, you will see such pattern. Now this is actually dusty plasma in the lab. You can see how properly ordered they are. See this? Has anybody heard about crystals? If not, don't worry. Crystals are atoms in a particular, they sit in a particular order. Now these are dusty plasma, dust particles in plasma. You prefer how properly they are behaving. Very nice, sitting where they are supposed to sit without any hangama. So dusty particles can be made to look like crystals. That's what you are seeing here. This is an hexagonal crystal. Now watch this interaction between the dust particles. As I said, when there is a plasma, particles have to interact. They are like nosy neighbors. He wants to know what he is doing. So the one particle sitting here wants to know what the entire particle sitting around it are doing. And he wants to interact with the ungli also. So let's see how this fellow behaves. Watch it. See? First everything sits properly, and then entirely the second sign of is gone. From an orderly state it goes to completely unorderly state and comes back there. So these are interesting aspects of dusty plasma. Okay, we go ahead. This is what I was talking about. Must have seen this, right? All you must have seen this. How the birds move. Now do you see any difference between this and what we just saw in dusty plasma? This is called collective behavior. If one bird moves out, everybody follows it. Why? You don't know. These are phenomena in nature that you find in various different fields of nature, but they are all related somehow. Don't ask me how, but it is there. But plasma is also like that.
If I may answer that,
birds
and animals, they still do not have an identity of I.
Mm.
It's a little deeper than what we understand. And a lot of that also seen as patterns in particles.
Probably, yeah.
So,
particles do
in fact
because of their charge. Yeah. So they do have an identity.
Yes. So why they have a charge, but they tend to, there is that attraction which keeps them bound, and they have a collective behavior.
Yes. There is also repulsion. Like two electrons, they will not attract, they will repel.
No,
both.
In specific, sure.
Both
but in specific, like the circle, the Saturn rings that you're talking about, you see there's a pattern of certain, with certain section of birds and animals also, you see the similar behavior.
Very good.
Which leads to this collective behavior.
Yeah.
So, the micro and the macro are innately connected to that extent.
Exactly. So again, as I said, Plasma requires a container to hold, like in a gas. You cannot hold gas without a container, right? So just expand it. Plasma also tends to expand. We need a container. The problem with giving a container to plasma is that if it's a hot plasma, you have to find an appropriate container. Let's go forward. I'll show you some examples of what we do in the lab. See, these are small diffusion devices. Why? Again, let me tell you how to make plasma. I showed you that you need a tube and two electrodes. You apply voltage, you have plasma inside. So that's what's called a linear device. And how do I get a continuous plasma? What I do is I just take it and bend it and make it like a piece of donut. And in an infinite loop, make a plasma inside. And that plasma, now I have to hold, because if I don't hold it, heat the walls, this charge, the walls of the container always on the ground. So if I don't contain the plasma inside this, that's the ground, and then it will become, it will recombine and becomes a gas. Let's see how this is a machine which we have in our institute. It's like a cycle tube. It has these magnetic coils here. See these red lines? They're all magnetic fields. Let's see what happens inside. Watch this area. When there is no magnetic field, you don't see a plasma. You see it glowing down. Now when I press the magnetic field, let's see what happens. See the light? See how the light is held in the center? Right? The blue light that you see is an argon plasma inside. And as long as the magnetic field is there, the plasma exists. Now once the magnetic field is removed, there is no plasma. That is the inherent safety built into any fusion reactor. And unlike a fission reactor wherein fission reactor is still safe, please don't consider the fission is not safe. One of the safest, and our Indian fission reactors are one of the safest in the world. But having said that, because of the kind of fuel it uses, it has issues. But in a fusion reactor, the heat comes from the plasma. You switch out the plasma, there is no heat, there is no fusion happening. That way it's inherently safe. That safeguard is built in. Let's take it one step further. So these are two of the plasma machines, tokamaks. We call it tokamak. It's just a Russian word saying that you can trap plasma in a cycle tube with magnets. It effectively translates into that. So you can see that on ground, here on the soil, too much of equipment around it. Actually, you cannot see the machine. But these are two machines that we have in our institute. One is called Aditya. Aditya, of course, means sun. And we are trying to bring the sun to Earth. So, you have Aditya. And this is one step. This is the big brother, very big brother. So, this uses superconducting magnets. This uses non-normal magnets. Why? It's a different question. If anybody is interested, I can answer it separately. Now, let's go forward. Not exactly the sun. You can say that. Yeah, sure. Well, let's see. In any science that we do, we cannot always do an experiment to find out. So that's the right way finally. But before you do an experiment, you actually find out in a lab using a computer, using the basic equations of physics to study whether what you're going to experiment is right or not. For example, let's take the sun. This is an actual image of the sun. How many of you have seen photos of surface of the sun? You should take a look. You cannot see. It's very interesting to see how, especially you look, Google for sun with H alpha filter. H alpha is the major emission from the sun. It's a red filter. You want to see only in that narrow filter. It's like wearing sunglasses. Wearing a red glass, everything in red. So only red light comes in. So you observe the sun with the H-alpha filter, it's going to look something like this. It's all pattern which you don't know why it happens. Now, it's the same thing which you have done using a huge supercomputer. You can simulate this phenomena, what is happening on sun, on Earth. And then you can, this will help you to predict sunspots. Sunspots are dangerous. The activity on the sun, that is solar flares, are dangerous. I'll come to that point later. But you can actually use computers to study the sun, and that will always help you. This is not only for the sun. For fusion also, we require, because I said, controlled plasma is very difficult. Plasma has its own mind. Now, we are trying to use computers to try to predict what the plasma will think, the plasma will do. If you can do that,
you hit the nail at the right point.
Let's go forward again. This I will quit. This I just wanted to show you how the plasma behaves like things in nature. You have this whirlpool, plasma also you will find things like this. Lightning, the streaks in lightning you can find in nature. You see waves, it produces waves. That also you see in the clouds. What you see is actual clouds. It's actually in plasma it has waves. So it follows many things that are seen in other systems in the nature. Then this is also streaks. Okay, now let us see. This is one slide I want to show you. Now you have your plasma now. So, and also it's very hot. So how do you study that? So when you go to the doctor, what does the doctor do first? He'll check your temperature, he'll ask you to do a blood test, ask you to do an x-ray. Why does the doctor need to do all that? He knows many things. Why should he do? He needs to know what is happening inside you. In the same way, when we create the plasma, it is too hot. I cannot put my finger and say, okay, this is now 100 degrees centigrade. I cannot do that. So I need to know non-contact methods to study the plasma, to understand what is my plasma temperature, how hot is it, how dense it is, how long it will last. I cannot touch it. So I need what is called a non-contact method. There are hundreds of methods. I just listed some of them. You don't have to bother much about it. It uses spectroscopy, that is looking at light. It's called spectroscopy. So we have microwave reflectometry. I throw some microwave into the plasma and I look for what is coming back or what is not coming back. And then I can say what is plasma behaving like. Fluorescence. I put some laser into the plasma and I see if the plasma shines or plasma does not shine. The plasma glows. I know that this is the condition in which plasma will glow. So this is the property. Then there is light scattering. Like, you know, again, there are particles inside, remember. These particles can scatter light. Raman scattering, all those have Raman scattering, right? Something called a Thomson scattering also. So you put laser into the plasma, plasma will scatter some of that light back. By catching that light, you can tell what is wrong with the plasma or what is good with the plasma. Then ion analyzer. If there is a plasma, there is electron as well as ion. If I can catch that, ions are very sluggish because they are big. So when you lock up the electron, whatever remains is the ion. Ions are big and sluggish. They move very slowly. They are bindas people. So you can catch them much faster than what you can catch an electron. By looking at the ions, you can tell the plasma is of this parameter. So, and of course, we have visible in camera. By looking at the photograph, by photographing the plasma at different wavelengths, you can look at different aspects of the plasma. So you can see how good old eye looking at the plasma. Okay? So because remember, plasma temperature and plasma density are the most two fundamental and essential parameters of the plasma. There are various others, but these are two things which are always required. Okay? So let's go forward again. Now, this is interesting. See, I just told you about spectroscopy. Spectroscopy is a science of looking at light from somewhere. How do you know that the star in one galaxy is having only diamonds in it? Recently, you have read somebody discovered an exoplanet which is completely diamonds, made of diamond. How do you know that? Diamond is carbon. So carbon will have a specific signature spectrum in it. Like all of us have our own signature, character. You can identify different characters. Every person is different. The same way, and we also, all of us have signature characters. If you know how to identify those characteristics, I know, for example, voice. Somebody listens to my voice over the phone, he knows it's me. How does he know? Because my voice is my signature. Exactly like that. Every material in this universe has got what is called as spectral character. If you take a white light, you can see the entire thing like this. Earlier I showed you the sodium lamp, only two lamps in yellow. That is sodium lamp's characteristics. Now we have absorption and emission spectrum. Absorption is what? Suppose the planet has an atmosphere of, let's say, sulfur. Venus. How do you know Venus has sulfur? Because when sun's light passes through the Venus atmosphere, it absorbs the sulfur lines. But you won't see from that. You see black lines. See this? In absorption, you see black lines. See? There's no line. Then I know that light passing through the Venus atmosphere has absorbed all the sulfur lines. That is absorption, same way as emission. So by these two things, you can actually study
different lights, plasma also can be studied. Now one question here. What commonly available material can be used to split light into its spectra?
Prism.
Prism is not a common thing. I'm talking about a household thing.
Plasma.
CD, there you are. That's one answer. Why do you think CD does that?
Because it has prism
light. Yes. So that acts like a grating. It's called a grating. What a grating does is, when light of different wavelengths comes through it, depending on the angle of incident, it will throw out different components of that light. Prism is also correct. And this is one more thing I'm looking for. Very common thing in your house. Have you ever spilled oil?
Water.
Yeah, have you ever spilled a drop of oil on water?
Yeah.
You will see different colors? Diffraction. So there are various methods by which you can actually split light into its. It's part of spectroscopy. That's the main tool that you use in spectroscopy. Okay? And this is used in for studying plasma.
Let us go ahead one more. Now, big question. Very common quality of studying this. You're able, all of us are able to hear Voice of America broadcast from USA in India, right? AM, not FM, AM. So how are we able to hear that? So far away, it's halfway around the globe. We are still able to hear Voice of America on your radio there.
It's
electromagnetic. Fine, agree that. How does it reach all the way here?
Your FM radio is from here. From here, if you go to, if you can you hear Mumbai FM radio in Pune? It's only how many? 150 miles from here? You cannot hear. But you can hear Voice of America from US here. Have you got a ionosphere? Earth, there's a layer around the Earth called the ionosphere. By the name, it still says that it's got ions in it. If you have ions in it, it has a plasma there. So somehow, the radio waves that are going up from USA get reflected back and forth, until it reaches Bombay here. So, and why not FM? Then why can't we hear USA FM station? FM is in megahertz, AM is in kilohertz. It's an order of three. One is in thousand, other is in mega. Now the thing is that our ionosphere has got the property with plasma density so much that you can reflect this kilohertz radiation. It goes up, comes down, and finally reaches here. But a FM, if it goes up, it just keeps going. This property of the plasma, if you use to study, I just told this just now. I put microwaves into the plasma and then look for what is coming back. Nothing comes back, all the microradius is gone, so that's not my density. If something comes back, I know that my plasma is at this particular density. So density of plasma, it depends on what kind of waves it can pass through and what kind of waves it can reflect. Now let's see this once more. See this? It starts and it reflects up and down. Finally it comes to the other point. Okay? So this is actually used for studying various aspects of plasma. Now, this is another very important thing. You can see this sun. These are solar flares that are ejected from the sun. Once in a while, from sun ejects solar flare. Look at Earth here. That's why this whole thing can completely burn off Earth. That does not happen. We are still here, right? How are we surviving this? Simply because of Earth's magnetic field. Because Earth has a magnetic field, all the charged particles coming are taken away from this. Only very few that comes towards the poles come into the Earth. That's why you see the lights in the polar regions only, Arctic region. Beyond that, the charged particles cannot come because of the magnetic field. So you have to thank Earth's magnetic field for our own survival. You can see other planets like Mars. Mars once had a good life. Now nothing is there. Because its atmosphere is gone. Magnetic field is gone. Someday it will happen to Earth. Once the Earth's mantle becomes solid, Earth will lose its magnetic field. Then we are also like a Mars, become like Mars. So magnetic field, all of us say thank you to our magnetic field. Now question is, what is the range of Earth's magnetic field? Any answer? Or any range of answer? Give me a range. Let's say our fridge magnet, all of you must have seen, right? Fridge. Why does the fridge close automatically? It's got a magnet on the door. As it closes.
compared to the Fred's magnetic field, how much higher or lower is Fred's magnetic field? Take a wild guess. You can always make wild guesses. 1,000 times, 100 times, million times. Earth's magnetic field is only Fred's magnetic field, let's say, is 100 gauss. Earth's magnetic field is 0.5 gauss. It's a very, very weak magnetic field. Even that very weak magnetic field is good enough to protect us. So you have respect towards magnetic field from now on. Okay? So let's go forward. Now we can use the same magnetic field to trap our plasma and make it work for us. Okay? Let's see how that is done. Okay, I will skip this. This is another thing. There's something called a space weather. These days people talk about space weather. Why? Because we have lot of spacecrafts in our atmosphere. And there is no magnetic field to protect the satellites. Now just imagine if our main satellite gets damaged. You go for other validation. It will say validation not data not found. Why? It cannot communicate to the server. So these days, health of the satellite is paramount. Because without that, many things, you cannot book your train tickets. Your flights will all get delayed. Recently, last week, there was Air India. Because the server got something happened, flights were delayed for 2 days for almost 8 hours each. Why? Because the main satellite which connects all the computers here was not functional. See, but we take things for granted, right? You go online, you can book your ticket, you can make a payment. But if the satellites don't behave well, that will not happen. And because satellites have to behave well, you have to look at constantly looking at the sun. You have to constantly monitor 24/7. Any activity on the sun will take at least from can take from few days to a week to affect us. Few days to a week to affect us. So in that we have only that much time to take evasive action. So what evasive action can you take? For example, satellite. You have seen those big solar panels in satellite. So if the sun is this side, my satellite, that's why I can turn it like this. So I'm exposing lesser area to the sun. So that way I can protect it a little bit. So space weather is very, very important these days. So nobody knows about it because everything happens in the background. But scientists today are looking at the sun 24/7 with all possible diagnostics. From X-ray to far infrared, they are observing, and that is why you need software which can predict the instabilities of the sun. But the more time you get more time for backup. So space weather is something you have to be very you should know something about. GPS, yes. The GPS will not work. The GPS will not work. You will not go from here to Dane these days. If I don't, I cannot go. I don't know the place. So GPS is completely functional on satellites. So if the solar flares comes and knocks them out, all dead. No planes will fly. That is what brings me. Has anybody heard of an EMP attack? This is what is called as a future weapons. There is no bomb, there is nothing. You won't even know. Only thing that will happen is all your phones will be dead. All the electronics will be dead. No communication will happen. It's called as electromagnetic pulse. Something like what comes from the sun. Okay, I can target it at one particular place. It will destroy all the electronics. So it will not kill any people. That is going to be the future war. Future of war is going to be electromagnetic completely. So let's go. I think I should move faster now. Okay, now this is another thing. Can you make microwave plasma at home? Actually you can. But then it comes with a big disclaimer. Okay? So let's see what this guy does. What he's doing is he's putting a small flame inside the plasma, which is microwave, shutting it, switching on the microwave. See what happens. Small candle he is putting. That's a small candle. The glass. Just covering the plasma, you can take some. That is because the flame is already a little bit plasma. So you are giving more energy to the plasma. This is exactly what we do in our photomicrograph. You see there in that exhibition, to increase the temperature of the plasma, you provide external energy to it. Exactly what this flow is doing. Now let's see what you can actually create.
It will not explode, sir.
It will explode after some time. That's why. That is why. Don't blame me if this happens. I mean, this pen, 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 pen for the mains, you know. So it happens. It will explode. Okay. Actually, there's a very famous experiment where they take a grape, cut it into so it doesn't split. It is still attached by the skin in the bottom. Put it in the microwave, cover it with the glass. Switch on the microwave. You produce glass by itself. So people have been doing this for a long time. Only recently they have actually given an explanation of why that happens. So you can make plasma at home, and you must have seen already neon lights also. You can see the experiment in the exhibition. How you can light a neon lamp using plasma. Okay?
So let's go.
Now why is plasma important? Because of so many applications. Every field you can use plasma, because that Chaya will tell you in detail. This area is where our institute, IPR, is actually involved in. You can see the amount of areas where plasma is used, right from agriculture, sterilization, skin diseases, nanotechnology, defense, thrusters for engines. Yeah, everywhere it is there, everywhere. So this is, you can see, environment, energy, industrial, strategic, social, and there are overlapping areas also. So this is very vast. This again, just somewhere application right from that again she will tell you. This experiment you can see here, plasma thruster. I'll explain it at the now just one. I'll just explain one application. Okay. This is for the previous generation, I would say. The olden days used to have this bulakar wheels. This would metal cappings on them. Which you see even now you can see in villages. You have the wooden wheel will have a metal cap. This way they put rubber over it. Fine, that earlier was not there. But what they used to do is they used to cover it with cow dung and then heat it, because you would expand the metal before putting it in. But why cow dung is the question? Because there is a process called plasma nitriding wherein you can actually increase the surface hardness of iron using plasma. Now, this is what happens in a plasma nitriding device. You put the gear, which is wherever there is a lot of any material that requires wear, that has wear and tear, you are exposed to plasma. I think the pink thing is the violet thing. Is it violet or pink? Okay, violet, fine. So this violet thing is the plasma. It covers the entire material. In this case also, what does the coagulant contain? Ammonia, right? Ammonia contains nitrogen. So that at high temperature, when you heat it, that nitrogen will penetrate into the iron wheel, make it harder on the surface. So wear and tear is decreased. So one technology that is used long back then, now it has become like this. So this is one example of, I just wanted to, this is one example. There are much more interesting things. I can show you a particular video. This is the so you can make plasma on textiles, either reject water or absorb water. So hydrophobic and hydrophilic. You can do both. Now this is actually a fabric. This is a droplet. Try to fall on it. See what happens when the droplet falls actually. Just roll it off. So you can make fabric either hydrophilic or hydrophobic. She will explain more. I'm not going into that. Now let's come to few slides on fusion. This is a very famous statement made by the earlier king of Dubai, not king, emperor of Dubai. He said, my grandfather rode a camel, my father rode a camel, I drive a Mercedes, my son drives a Land Rover, his son will drive a Land Rover, and his son will ride a camel. Why did he say this? Because he was aware that the fossil fuels, which is what is the Middle East money coming from, that will end. So fossil fuels will end, oil will end in 53 years approximately, gas 54 years, and coal in 110 years. Nuclear fuels, at today's usage, will last another 80 years. And renewable sources, will last forever. But they are not as efficient as other methods. You can still have it. Only 19% it can do. What about the remaining percent? That is, so what do? So we have to get to fusion. We have fission in one side. Fusion on one side. One, it splits, other, it combines. So in this case, you combine
to you combine deuterium tritium, which are cousins of hydrogen, bad cousins. So you bind them together in high temperature, you get one fluorine gets extra. Because there's something called as your mass can either be created or destroyed. If I have to join, this fluorine comes out as a neutron, very high energy. Now you can ask me, how high is this energy? So this energy is so high, this small neutron that comes out of this, if I let it go, it will travel from Earth to Moon in 8 seconds. It is that fast. Fast means high energy. High energy means you extract more energy. So if I capture this guy, take out the energy, I can use it for commercial purposes. Right? That is what the ITER program is trying to do. Okay? Let's see what exactly is this fusion business. It's nothing. Actually, create plasma, confine it, then you try to control it. That's the thing. So, you can see this. Our sun consumes 600 million tons of hydrogen every second. That will bring it for millions of years. It will continue to be for millions of years. So, we have no problem. Later on, next generation, next 1000 generations, we might have problem. So, what do? Is it possible to reproduce the working of the sun on another? This is a question which the fusion people are actually trying to demonstrate. ITER will demonstrate that we can actually extract useful energy from a fusion system. So how do you do it? It's very simple actually. You create a plasma, take it to high temperatures, add appropriate fuel, obtain sufficient density, and hold the density and temperature for sufficiently long time. You have fusion, very simple. It's easier said than done. Fusion experiments have started many decades ago, and we are still decades away from actually getting energy from fusion. So will mankind manage to bottle the sun? Let us see. This is what you catch the sun, put it in a bottle, and then your energy is, that is called fusion. Okay? So I hope that fusion will be able to do things that. So this is what is the current state evolution document. I can see that how the old machines are. This is the one which is being exhibited in the exhibition. Once this becomes a success, then you have, look at the size difference. Almost 5 times the size. What is the name of India's first tokamak?
Aditya.
Very good. I don't know who said first. Yeah. She said in the front. Okay. So this one line I want to say this. This is cold, oil, this is the uranium, etc. And this is the equivalent fuel required for fusion. That means, if I have the lithium in one of your mobile phones, that mobile phone batteries are made of lithium. If I have the lithium for one of your mobile phones, I can provide energy for a town for a day. That is the amount of decrease in quantity of fuel that is required. And 30 liters of seawater, if you give me one gram of deuterium, that is the energy equivalent of almost 9000 liters of petrol. So you can imagine you can see the difference in the savings that we have in fuel. And seawater is available at the end. What is the percentage of our?
75.
Who says 75? Come little down.
71.
72. Yes, pass. Okay? Okay, I think. Few words about our institute, I have to say this. We are we belong to the BAE, the Department of Atomic Energy family, and this is our timeline. We actually belong, initially started off at the Physical Research Laboratory, which was started by Baba, Sarabhai. Then we grew bigger, and that house became too small for us. So we established our own system. In the front end, we built the first tokamak, then we have a superconducting tokamak. Then we have the HAPT, which is a division which deals with industrial applications of plasma. This is C1T converter. We joined ITER program. That's why we are here as an exhibition here. We have three machines in our institute. We also have a branch in Guwahati, which joined us in 2013. And these are the three campuses that we have. So this is the general work we do. Basic experiments in plasma. Studies in high temperature, magnetically confined plasma, industrial plasma, development of reactor relevant technology. Because as I said, the physics of fusion is very clear. The engineering is lightning speed by 40 years. It will be locked to catch up. So that catching up thing is what we do.
So these are again experiments that happen in our institute. This I'm not going into. So that's it. Thank you very much for listening to me.
So if you have any questions, I can quickly answer before the next one starts up. No questions. That means only two things. Either you understood everything or you understood nothing. Okay, thank you very much.